favorite cartoon characters will help you understand how drugs and alcohol can ruin your life. So watch the program. Talk about it with your family.
Presentation with Mike and Ethan, or
Alf will not be seen tonight.
After what we did a couple of weeks ago with Nathan Masri, I was trying to think of something that would that matched in the same kind of family as that for Peanuts. I was like, is there something that feels like someone is taking advantage of Charles Schultz? And I thought this was going to be it. I thought this was some sort of ridiculous thing that some vanity project that some weirdo had talked Charles Schultz into bankrolling and including a Snoopy cameo in. Friends, the weirdo was Charles Schultz himself. This is The Big Stuffed Dog, a movie starring Snoopy as an anonymous stuffed dog.
Yes. So this was a made-for-TV joint, wasn't it? I'm assuming yes. This did not go to theaters.
It would be kind of, it would be pretty short for theaters. Yeah, it's a 50 minute long movie from 1981. That wow, it's very 1981. This feels like Welcome Back, Norman.
Yeah, it's watching this film. I was struck by, well, you know, obviously. When you make a movie, you don't make it 100% accurate to life. You know, you fudge things a little bit. So I don't expect that this was an accurate 100% depiction of life in 1981, but it had to be close enough that people wouldn't watch this and be like, what the fuck is going on here? And watching it is, it's weird how much life has changed in small yeah. ways.
I mean, not to say that I didn't say what the fuck is going on here, but...
Yeah, but I mean, that's the thing is like, if you make a movie in 2023, you have to make it, you have to fudge it a little bit so that the things happening on screen aren't necessarily, it isn't exactly how things would happen in real life. Because if you did that, any movie you make would involve the entire cast getting arrested in like the first 5 minutes, you know? this one was, okay, so... do we know anything about what the genesis of this film, like what was Charles Schultz thinking here? It seems like he was trying to get away from Peanuts a little bit and stretch his legs. But maybe the studio was like, no, it gotta be Peanuts. You gotta have Snoopy. He's like, all right, we'll put Snoopy in it, but we won't say he's Snoopy.
I have no clue how this got started. All I know is that Charles Schultz wrote the screenplay, and apparently his quote on it was that it was a pleasure to work with adults who could actually act.
That is, I will say that is one thing that is better about this than a lot of the Peanuts specials is it does yeah. have legitimate actors in it. There's some fairly big names. Abe Vigoda's in this.
Yeah, Fish.
And a bunch of other people who I am blanking on right now. But when you see them, they're like, oh, I know that guy. They're working yeah. actors that you see in lots of stuff. But the basic idea is there's a kid. He has a big, big stuffed dog.
He has a 6-foot-tall Snoopy doll, yeah. the same ones that they were showing in the toy store segment of the Snoopy musical on ice.
Yeah.
And I got to say one thing about this dog. This is his beloved toy that he carries everywhere with him, and it is spotless. This is the cleanest, comfy object I've ever seen.
Yeah. this toy, this dog, this big stuffed dog, So the boy, he's going on a trip, and through a series of wacky coincidences, the big stuffed dog gets lost, and various people encounter it and have adventures, and then in the end, it's reunited with the kid. This is a standard plot that you've seen happen a lot. You know, it's basically Pee-wee's Big Adventure, but with a Snoopy. You know,
What it made me think of was this is the kind of thing that they would make a 7-minute film out of and show it on like Pinwheel or Eureka's Castle.
Yes, that's exactly it. Now, at 50 minutes.
It runs a little long.
I've said in the past that I kind of blow hot and cold on Charles Schultz.
Yeah.
Sometimes I think like, oh God, what a hack. And sometimes I think, no, there's something there. He really taps into something universal and true about the human condition. And I think watching the big blue dog, sorry, the big stuffed dog, it really made me realize, oh, it's not that I blow hot and cold on Charles Schultz, is that Charles Schultz, his output is so all over the place, because sometimes he's on his game and sometimes he's not.
I understand, and I feel like you see elements of both of those in this one.
Yeah, I'm probably not going to be very charitable to this one, because
I understand, but you know, this is an example of how the default emotion that comes with anything by Charles Schultz is melancholy.
Yes.
And when he tries to do something that's genuinely happy and joyful, it comes across as fake. It comes across as him being like, this is how real people feel, right? Not messed up people like me. But when it's time to do something about messed up, lonely, hurt people, then he's on his game.
Yeah, that's his thing. He's God's lonely man, you know?
Yeah.
Like you said, this would have been better as a short, because that when it gets melancholy, I won't say that it's something I enjoyed, but yeah, it's like you can tell that's where
you felt something.
Yeah, like those are the moments when Schultz is like he's on his game, like he knows how to do sad stuff, or I don't know, he understands Weltschmerz in a way that I think very few people who have his reach do, because generally it's just funny, because it's like, you know, most people who get rich and famous and on creative stuff generally are like, hey, here's some happy stuff to make you feel good, because people like to feel good, you know, that's generally so. You know, you don't watch Mickey Mouse to be sad. You don't watch Bugs Bunny to be sad. You know, most people who do well, like, that's why it's so funny right now when everyone's saying, like, oh, there's such a backlash against happy endings. What are you talking about? Everyone loves happy endings. That's the thing. So,
there's a reason there's no such thing as stand-up tragedy.
Yeah. So Charles Schultz really...
My mother-in-law is so fat, she'll never play piano again.
Oh, actually, maybe that's not so bad. I laughed. But this particular Snoopy thing, yeah, it's 50 minutes.
Yeah, it's 50 minutes, and it's really hilarious that this is a movie all about a giant, bigger than life-sized Snoopy doll, and not once does anyone say, look, it's Snoopy.
Yeah.
It's this alternate reality where there's no peanuts. It feels like Charles Schultz trying to make his own It's a Wonderful Life.
Yeah, well, that's why I thought maybe he was trying to get away from peanuts. Maybe he thought, like, you know, I've been doing peanuts for, like, 50 years. I'll show him that I can do something else. I'll show him that I've got range. And
he did not have range.
He did not have range. I'm sorry, but, like, this is really... It's very similar I guess, to the girl in the red truck, Charlie Brown,
Yeah,
in the
I think it's
sense
better than the girl in the red truck, but
it is slightly better.
I mean, yeah, it's better to watch, but it is not going to stick with you in the way that the girl in the red truck does.
No. I think the issue is this is just like it's a series of extremely low stakes low stakes events with characters who don't have real problems. So it's the same thing because in the girl in the red truck, it was like, okay, what's the plot of this? Oh, well, the girl in the red truck wants to like roller skate in her hometown, but her boyfriend thinks she should go to the big city. And in the end, they agree that she should stay in the hometown. It's like, oh, okay, well, I guess I'm glad they resolved that.
It's a bad plot, but it's a plot.
Yeah.
Whereas this one comes across as more like a bunch of miniature, not very good Twilight Zone episodes sort of stitched together by this dog.
It's like watch it. It made me think of what is it, the movie with the parrot that encounters a bunch of people and helps them with their problems.
With Dunstan checks in?
Oh,
No.
maybe that sounds right. It's pro something like
No.
that.
No, that has a chimp.
Oh, okay.
I
Well, it
don't.
was probably the same
Oh.
idea.
Oh, is it Polly?
That's
Is that
it.
it?
That's of course I should have known it was Polly. It's a parrot.
Paulie. So
Oh.
yeah.
Okay, that's why I forgot. Okay, well, let's go through this film because from the start, well, first of all, it's our main kid. Does the kid have a name? I don't remember if the kid has a name.
I do not remember if the kid has a name. He is this, freckle-faced, mop-haired kid that, should be in a cereal commercial, and but he's wearing a grandpa sweater through the whole movie, and yeah, and then we have his mom and dad, who and mom is just, she has embraced the idea of being a TV mom in the ruffled apron and everything, and dad is like kind of John Ritter-ish, and.
And the issue here is the kid is going to go on a plane to visit his grandfather, and I guess he doesn't want to be away from his Snoopy doll. So the mom is like, "Oh, it's okay. I bought a second ticket for Snoopy, so this giant Snoopy can sit next to you on the plane,"
Yes.
which immediately tells you like how much the world has changed because in 2023 that's like yeah I dropped an extra $3,000 so that you could fly with your giant Snoopy doll. It's like no, you wouldn't do that nowadays, but I guess in the world of
No.
1981 air flight was still fairly cheap. But the debt
And I mean, you would immediately get bumped if that happened. The second that somebody saw that the seat had been bought for a dog, they'd be like, "Okay, you're off."
Which is kind of almost what happens. Not but before we get there, like the dad doesn't like this. The dad is like, we should put our feet down and not let him do this. And the mom is like, oh, but he really likes the doll. And quite frankly, I'm kind of on the dad's side with this because it's like, come
Yes.
on, you're gonna buy an
It's a
extra.
6-foot doll, and he hasn't even named it. He doesn't even call it Snoopy. He just says my dog. How attached can he be to it?
Yeah, for real. I did think the bit with about Charlie McCarthy was kind of funny.
It is kind of funny because yeah, Dad, there was this whole story about how Mom was like, "Oh yeah, what about that Charlie McCarthy doll you took with me you to camp and everyone made fun of you and you had to stay home come home a week early?" He's like, "You know a lot about this, Mom. Were you there?"
She was one of the kids making fun of him. That's how they
Yeah,
met.
she threw a rock at him. And but the thing is, okay, this is 1981. They have a kid who's what, 6, 8?
Oh,
It's
I'm not
like,
sure how old he's supposed to be. Yeah, I assume
yeah.
he.
So I'm trying to judge the parents' ages and like, what is this guy old enough to have known about Charlie McCarthy if he has a 6-year-old in 1981?
It's hard to judge people's ages in the 80s because people
They all dress
aged.
like your
Yeah,
grandparents.
exactly. They all dress like your grandparents, and they lived in a haze of leaded gasoline and cigarette smoke, so everybody looks ancient. Even like the like a grandpa in the 80s will come out and he looks like he's 100. It turns out he's 50, you know? So
Yeah.
that's a thing. These parents are probably younger than us, but they just look like old people. you know?
Yeah.
It's like how, it's like the parents on Marvin, where you're like, oh yeah, they're just, they're like, what are they, 100?
Yeah. Yeah, these are parents who are dressed up for their job as parents.
Yeah, know? Yeah. And yeah, you know, I think that's part of this, part of the issue with this film is you really do feel like people appear on screen and the moment that they're off screen, they just cease to exist. They don't have lives. You know, Charles Schultz has not written this so that I feel like any of these characters have lives beyond what we're seeing on screen. But they go to the airport with the kid, and again, showing how different the world is, there's a dude at the airport who's like, I need a ticket on this plane that's leaving. I need the ticket. It's like, okay, you could do that back then? Because nowadays, it's like, you buy,
they'd be like, you know, get, you know, spread eagle on the ground. Let us see what's in your pockets.
Yeah, exactly. It's like, I'm sorry, you didn't buy your ticket 3 months in advance. Well, you know, but yeah, there, this guy is just like, I need to get on the plane. And when they find out that they're bought a ticket for the dog, he kind of badgers him into letting, it's kind of weird because,
I'm on his side here, honestly.
Yeah, I was a little confused because I thought the guy should just be like, look, lady, I'll pay you for the dog's ticket. But it doesn't seem that actually happens. I'm not really, it sounds like.
They talk about how they're going to refund the woman and the guy's going to buy the ticket.
Oh, okay. All right. Seems like it would be easier just to let him buy the ticket from the woman, but okay. Actually, I guess in those days, it's not like people had Venmo, so there was, unless he had cash on him, there's no way that he could have like paid the woman directly, because it's not like you can accept credit card payments from random people in 1981. All right, fine.
It is a different world.
Yeah. It's okay. So I withdraw that complaint. But what happens?
But then, the problem is, the kid just is like, okay, well, if the dog's going in baggage, then I'll just shove him through the baggage claim.
Yeah, and it was like, why would you do that? Oh, because that way they don't put the little tag on him, so that's why the dog ends up getting misrouted. Or actually, I don't think the dog goes anywhere.
The dog does not leave the airport. The baggage claim guy picks him up and puts him on the outgoing stuff. And so that is where we get our ridiculous Beagle Boys-esque villains.
Yeah, this gang of suspiciously middle-aged bikers.
they're taking part in some kind of smuggling here, and they've pulled off a crime or something, and they've been told that they're going to be getting their money stuffed into a stuffed animal. And the big dog comes down the carousel first, and they grab it and they miss that a doll that looks like Rocket Raccoon comes down right behind it. So
yeah.
As it
so yeah, it's one of those things where it's like, oh, what an astounding coincidence that like there just happens to be this this kind of drug mule type exchange happening in the airport with inside a large stuffed animal. But the bikers,
four very large, very noisy men who push and shove literally anyone in their path or out of it to get where they're going, you know, constantly, you know, doing the whole spread out your mugs kind of thing. And
yeah.
It's like, and nobody noticed this.
Now, it's also funny.
We were all just more rude back then, I guess.
they were told by their connection. We never find out exactly what this money is for. It just seems very much like a drug exchange to me.
Whacked Jim Davis.
Yeah. They're like, make it look like an accident. they are told that there's going to be $5,000 in 1981 money inside a large stuffed animal. And
$5,000 in 1981 money, that's like 30 grand now. Shit.
I mean, you could buy like the whole plane for that amount.
You could buy the monocle off Rockefeller's eyeball.
Now, my thing, though, is, they grab they see the big stuffed dog, and they make the obvious conclusion that that's the stuffed animal they're supposed to get get, right? Because it's huge. It's a giant.
Right.
But then after they leave, that Rocket Raccoon stuffed animal comes through, which is about the size of, you know, an average teddy bear that a six-year-old girl would have. You know, it's...
Right.
You know, it's pretty small. And I was thinking, like, come on! If you're going to, like, put $5,000 in a stuffed animal, yeah, put it in a giant one, because a little one like that is going to get lost somewhere in transit. It's tiny! You know? Or just put it in a fucking suitcase at that point. It's less conspicuous. But...
Oh, I was off. You know, oh, 15 grand. Still pretty good.
That's still pretty good.
Yeah, shit.
I mean, you can see why these bikers...
I'd whack Jim Davis for that.
For $15,000?
Well, okay, no, not Jim Davis.
Okay, well, no. I'm just curious. I'm just asking. Just asking. Writing down for future reference. You know, if I need to get Jim Davis whacked, how much it's going to cost me?
Yeah, if you want me to whack the Marvin guy, free.
Okay. How much for let's work this out a little bit. How much for Bill Watterson?
Bill Watterson? Oh, you can't afford. If you gotta ask, you can't afford it.
Okay. Well, how about Mel Lazarus?
Mel Lazarus? Oh, $500 straight up.
Okay. All right. I can
pay first.
All right. Well, we'll talk after the show. Anyway, so the bikers get the big stuffed dog, and they bike away, but it immediately falls off the back of their bike and just
cartoonishly bounces off the back of their bike like it literally jumped.
Yes,
but. You know, it's another thing. This doll is literally big enough to wear as a costume, but no one ever does. And it never does any kind of walking around or anything. It's just a plush.
Yeah, you know, they
it
never...
It seems like... I thought there was going to be a sort of Mac and Me thing where the dog waves goodbye or something. Nothing.
Oh, man. Yeah, they really missed an opportunity there. Well, this sets up our first... meeting, and this is where Charles Schultz is like, I'm gonna get real melancholy, like melancholy. You feel you ready to be depressed? Well,
this gets really depressing in a hurry as a dried up old lady finds the dog and carries him home, sets him in the chair where her late husband used to always sit, and starts talking about how it's nice to have somebody to talk to because, you know, even when someone does come over, it always feels like they're just fulfilling an obligation. starts talking about her, the marbles she won as a kid and how each marble in her collection means something to her. Like Uncle Scrooge knowing the date on every dime.
And
here's another big thing for, I don't know about boomers, maybe it's a silent thing, but Big Little books. You know about these?
I've never heard of these, but explain.
They've definitely been mentioned in Peanuts before.
Wait, are they Big Little books or Fat Little books?
Big Little books, yeah, because there are these books with, like, you know, one page of text, one illustration, one page of text, one full page illustration. So they were real popular. They were kind of almost an alternative to comics for some kids.
I do know what those are. I have seen those in thrift shops. And
yes,
it's very often.
They were a big deal.
Yeah, like it'll be, they're usually like, Sylvester and Tweety go to El Dorado or something like that. They're always some wacky thing like that. I didn't know that's what they're called, but now that you mention it, it's like I have seen those before. They mentioned this, and I just assumed it was another weird thing that Schultz was obsessed with, like Zambonis.
Yeah, it is kind of. There's definitely a strip where I almost called him Peanuts. Charlie Brown goes to Lucy's psychiatric stand and is like, well, it's not about me, it's about my dad. He just seems to be in such a funk and I don't know what to do about it. You know, all he does is, you know, lie on the couch and read his old Big Little books. And Lucy's like, how old is your dad? He just turned 40. Why? Oh, right on schedule. 5 cents, please.
Well, I guess that's what you do when you're 40 and you're a silent generation person. You just
I mean, we're that just shows how far ahead of schedule we are. Because I mean, I started doing that when I was 20. So shit.
Sitting around reading your Big Little books.
Yeah, my. I mean, how do you think I became the hungry reader?
Well, luckily,
I wasn't bitten by a radioactive book.
Luckily, this woman dies. So. So we don't need to like deal with this depressing thing, this depressing lady very long. But
her schmuck grandson comes to visit her the next day and finds that they've already carted her body away.
You know, I gotta say, I kind of feel for the schmuck grandson, you know?
Yeah, I mean, it's not like he, you know, it's not like he has nothing to do but visit his grandmother.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure I'm sure he's busy, you know, being an adult. It's like maybe Schultz, you should blame society if people don't have enough time to visit their elders. But what annoys me about this is we meet the landlord. Okay, this old lady's landlord. I forget who plays the landlord. I feel like he's a known actor, though.
Oh, is it?
Let me look. The Big Stuffed Dog.
Is it Mel Stewart?
Let's see. Is it Mel Stewart?
Yeah, best known for playing Henry Jefferson on All in the Family.
Oh, okay. All right, there we go. So, this is the thing, though. So the grandson shows up and he's like, "Oh, I'm here to visit my grandmother. Oh, I've been really busy. I haven't like been able to come for 2 weeks." And Mel Stewart is all like, "6 weeks." And he's all like, oh, okay. And then Mel Stewart's like, "Yeah, your grandmother's dead. We carted her body away." And it's like, wait a minute. So you knew this guy shows up, you know, you're about to like drop this bombshell that his grandmother died. But first you take the time to fucking guilt trip him about not visiting enough? I mean, come on, man. That is some real bullshit. It's just...
She died of a broken heart.
Yeah, it's like... and the thing is, the way this landlord is written, I feel like we're supposed to kind of like him as kind of a straight shooter type character, but he's just kind of an asshole, you know?
Yeah.
Like, it's like, oh yeah, okay, maybe this grandson is, you know, not the best... You know, obviously not the best guy, but like, come on, yeah. His grandmother just died. He just found out, and you're gonna. And the same thing when like he's all like, "Well, I guess you can, you know, I guess you can sell her stuff here, and I don't know, maybe some of these."
He's
books.
Like, he's already doing it. Yeah.
Yeah, and he's like, "Well, I guess maybe some of these books. You think you can get some money for them?" And the landlord's like, "They're called Big Little Books." It's like, who gives a shit, man?
Oh, well, I like what he said there. You know, he says that because he says it so contemptuously. Are these worth anything? These fat little books.
I just think like, it's...
Make something of yourself, books. Look at that gut.
I feel like the landlord is just like kind of a Schultz surrogate here. Like Schultz is like, stupid kids nowadays don't even know what Big Little Books are, you know? But it's like, well, why would he know? I'm sorry. He's not like, he's not Silent Generation. He's not 100 years old. Yeah, he doesn't know what these stupid books are called. but then it is funny when they're like, when they're selling the stuff and the landlord's like, "We sold everything except these books and this dog." And everyone's like, they're doing the estate sale and everyone's looking at this dog like it's a sacred totem or something. You know? Like they're really like, everyone is just like, fascinated by this dog, and it's like it's just literally a big stuffed dog.
Yeah. And it's wild that again, it's such a strange look into an alternate universe where Snoopy is unknown. It's just a random design for a stuffed dog.
Yeah.
I was sure that there were actually Peanuts Big Little Books, but I looked it up and I couldn't find one.
Oh, actually I'd be surprised if there weren't, but you know, it is funny. Looking at the cast for this film, I feel that there's a misattribution because I think the old lady, is credited as Petey's grandmother.
Petey's grandmother, Mildred Dunnock.
Yeah. Mm. Because Petey is the main, like, redheaded kid. He has a grandfather.
Right.
We never see him with a grandmother. So, and there is no one else credited as old lady. So I think that's a goof up on in the credits there. They were like, yeah, old people, same difference. One grandma's the same as another. But
does it give her actual? Oh no, Lily is the little girl,
right?
Okay. Noah Beery, I feel like I've seen him before somewhere.
He looks like Noah Beery, who plays the grandfather. He is. Let's see. Wait 1 second. He looks like someone who plays grandfathers a lot.
Yes.
You know. So Noah Beery Jr., he is also, let's take a look, at his, he was on the Rockford Files, Walking Tall, Red River, Trapper John, M.D., Murder, She Wrote, The Love Boat, The Quest, Waltz Against Texas, The Best Little Whorehouse in Texas, Magical World of Disney, The Capture of Grizzly Adams, and Magnum P.I. So he is a working actor. He's been in a lot of stuff.
Yeah, everyone here has been in a bunch of things. So.
Yeah. So I guess they're trying to sell, you know,
they're trying to sell the lady's, possessions at a estate sale on the sidewalk. And that is when, Abe Vigoda pulls up in his tiny Volvo and is like, how much for the dog? I'll give you $10 for the dog. Here's $10. Thanks. And of course the guy was about to ask for about twice that, but this guy just manhandles him into giving him the dog for $10 and drives away. And then we see what he does for a living, which is that he runs a carnival booth and has to have some big, impressive thing to pull people in with.
Yeah. I thought, again, this was another thing where we're supposed to, like, feel like, you know, that the landlord is like, oh, he's just an honest, straight shooter. And he was, like, got kind of swindled. But it's like, dude, whatever. It was a free dog. You didn't. You're just selling an old dead lady's stuff. Be happy for what you got. So Abe Vigoda runs a carnival booth, and but there's this girl who really wants to. I guess she wants to win.
She wants to win something. The actual big stuffed dog is not available just yet.
Yeah.
So she hasn't seen it. But she has been practicing in this an abandoned house with a little boy who is blowing up balloons for her, and she is practicing throwing darts at them.
Yeah, so. She just has a vendetta against this carny and wants to, like, really rub his nose in it when she pops all the balloons and wins the big prize. So this next sequence is basically she goes to the carnival and she's like, "I'm gonna win the prize. Give me all the darts," and she starts popping balloons, and she pops all the balloons, and Abe Vigoda is like, "I ain't giving you the dog," and which is funny because it's like a large crowd has gathered, you know?
Yeah, a crowd who is like, "Yeah, she's earned it. And I guess that gives her bargaining power because she's able to set some of the terms of the bargain, which is to, you know, if she hits one last balloon, then he'll give her the dog. And she manages to talk him into giving her a roll of tickets for rides.
I feel like
he shouldn't have that. I don't.
Yeah,
oh,
I don't
this
know
is
why
Paramount's Great America.
This whole thing with is kind of just, I don't know. It's a little goofy because I was like, Abe Vigoda, like, She just spent $25. You've already made twice back what you spent on the dumb dog. And there's this huge, very belligerent crowd gathering. Just give her the dog, you know? But I guess he does one. He's like, no, one last balloon that you have to hit. It's like, you think she's not going to hit that? She's hit every balloon so far. And of course she hits it.
He made back half of what he spent on the dog because she had $5 worth of quarters. And, he spent 10 on the dog. So.
Oh, sorry. Never mind. Well, no wonder he was so reluctant to let it go. I thought that she spent $20 in quarters. My bad.
Now she had 20 quarters total.
Oh, well, 20 quarters is like $20 in like 1981 money.
Yeah, that's for sure.
But she gets the dog they ride on a bunch of rides with the dog,
and the dog gets injured.
Yeah, the dog gets injured because his nose starts coming off, and so
She drags the dog on a red wagon to a children's hospital, and this is just, you know, not even maudlin. This is just like children taking advantage of adults by putting on their, you know, best little boy in the whole wide world face.
Yeah. I mean, how old is this girl supposed to be? About 10, I'm thinking?
I think so. Yeah, she looks like she's about to hit puberty, but not quite.
Right. And that's my thing. Is like, look, when I was 10, if I had a toy that's broken, I know the difference between a tailor and a doctor. So I'm not going to go to the fucking hospital with it. But she brings to the
hospital. Once again, a tremendous coincidence works in this dog's favor.
Yes. So she takes it to the hospital because she needs a surgeon to reattach the nose. And, you know, it's like, oh, I get it. It's very twee. It's very cute. Okay, whatever. But here's the thing. It's like, meanwhile, in the children's ward, right? All the kids are there. They're in the ward, and it's like, and there's
this
a
was
kid.
The state of medicine in 1981, huh?
Yeah, because there's one kid, and he's like, he has surgery the next day, and he's scared, right? He's so scared about his surgery. What's a surgery? He's getting his tonsils out.
Yeah.
Now I was under
the most routine thing ever.
Yeah, I was under the impression that's a pretty standard outpatient thing, so you don't need to be in the hospital overnight the night before a tonsillectomy. So what the hell's going on here?
They always do that in movies and TV. They're always like, oh, you have to stay overnight at the hospital when you get your tonsils out. I saw, you know, not just this. It was a thing in the Family Circus when Jeffy had his tonsils out. It was a thing on Garfield when John had his tonsils out.
Was the state of medicine just like positively medieval in 1981? Like they just... You know,
I mean, I don't think we even remove tonsils anymore. I think we just treat it with antibiotics.
Oh, really? Man, what a world. But apparently, you know, in 1981, this kid is in the hospital for this experimental tonsillectomy procedure. and
if this goes right, this kid will have tonsils the size of grapefruit.
This kid's pretty worried. But, again, this is the thing about this movie. It's low stakes for people with no problems. Because,
yes.
I mean, I'm sorry. Like, he's scared that he's having routine surgery? Whatever. It's not even a real thing. I thought these were a bunch of cancer kids or something. But, no, it's just tonsil kids. It's like, whatever. But the nurse is all like, well...
Sorry, kid. We'll add a patch for you on the world tonsils quilt.
Now this nurse, she's a smart one, because she figures out that, like, well, this kid's scared, so we gotta set him at ease, I guess, because otherwise he might be too scared, and I don't know, I guess I don't know what it matters. You're gonna knock him out when you do this thing anyway,
yeah.
Aren't you? I mean it's not local anesthetic when you do a tonsillectomy, is it? I hope not.
I only ever got knocked out for my wisdom teeth, personally.
Yeah, same. I guess I don't know how they do a tonsillectomy, but they want this kid to not be scared. So the nurse brings the giant Snoopy doll to the doctor, I guess the surgeon who's going to be doing the tonsils, and she's all like, okay, demonstrate to the kids how you sew a nose back on this dog so they'll feel like they're in good hands.
Yeah, that'll definitely show you how a tonsillectomy works.
Yeah, and it's like, well, I mean, I guess it works because these kids are not scared anymore after they watch this. But it's just like, I don't know.
Wouldn't it be great if after the end credits, we were like, wake up, your tonsillectomy went fine, though there was one complication, and the kid wakes up and he has a huge black plush nose.
Well, you know, that would actually make this whole thing worth it. Well, they take the kid, the kid sees the dog get fixed, and...
Not the way you're thinking.
No, no. Well, the thing is, like, this whole thing, I'm just rolling my eyes the whole time because it's like, Charles Schultz, you know, there's no stakes here. It's like, it's a lot of who cares. Like, at least the part with the old lady, it's like, look, there's some actual pathos in that scene, you know?
Yes.
Like
That meant something. This just felt like, you know, killing time.
Yeah, seriously. I feel like Charles Schultz was like, when they were like, okay, you can't make the whole thing depressing. And he's like, well, what else? What other emotions are there? I just don't know.
Is cute an emotion?
It's like, apparently so. He's just, so they do the thing, right? Then the girl is going home with the big stuffed dog in her wagon. Mm-hmm. And is this movie, I think, does it take place in San Francisco? Because I feel like some of the shots look like San Francisco, the really slopey hill streets of San Francisco. But
that would make sense because they went to Great America and that's in like Santa Clara, right?
Oh, okay. So I'm going to assume then, because it looked like San Francisco, that this is supposed to be San Francisco. So this little girl is wandering the streets of San Francisco in the middle of the night with their giant dog in a wagon. And these two cops pull up and they're like, we can give you a ride if you want to abandon your wagon. And she's like, no. And they're like,
she's like, ACAB, motherfuckers.
Yeah, and they're just like, okay, bye. Just like, yeah, sure. Have fun wandering the streets. Now,
she said that she couldn't leave the wagon behind because it didn't belong to her. So
I'm sorry, you can't get the wagon in the back of a cruiser? You know you can. It's not even a big wagon. But then, unfortunately, those bikers, they see her, right?
Yeah. So so she gets chased by the Beagle Boys, and she goes through a wire fence into what I thought was a ponding basin, but it seems to be something different. Maybe it's a park.
Yeah, it's some sort of, I guess it's some sort of park, and then there's a giant wicker basket that she puts the dog in.
Oh, yes. Yes, now we're going to burn you for spring.
Yeah, I mean, immediately when you see that, you're like, oh, okay,
we go.
Here's some more wacky coincidences. And sure enough,
it would have been less of a giveaway if you hadn't had a hot air balloon be the first thing you see over the credits.
Yeah, well, it turns out the next day when it's bright and sunny, there's this couple who is getting married in a hot air balloon. Because why not?
Yes.
This just,
they're getting out in a hot air balloon of the guys, and someone says, well, he thought it was his only way to making sure that they were all alone after the wedding.
They're going to fuck in a hot air balloon, I guess.
I wonder what that's like. Well,
I guess it could be romantic, I guess. Yeah. I mean, I honestly, I don't think I'd really be into it, personally. Because I feel like, I mean, I'm not good with heights, you know?
Oh, well, you're not?
Well, not really.
Well, I'm okay with heights, but I don't have a height-philia, so that would...
Yeah.
So I wonder if this has come up before, and he's always like, you know, when they have sex, he's like, talk to me like we're in an airplane that's going down.
Yeah, they're joining the Mile High Club here.
Yeah.
I mean, because the thing is, like, God, I guess I wouldn't do it on an airplane, because where would you do it on an airplane? You have to do it in the bathroom, and those things are just, no, there's no space. How are you gonna do it?
Yeah. I had to hold my breath to fit in the bathroom.
Yeah, exactly. Like last time I was on an airplane, it's like, look, I can barely fit in a bathroom myself on these airplanes now. I'm not gonna be fitting
half my size.
Yeah. I'm not gonna, you get another person in there. Like, how are you gonna even, I don't even know how you would arrange so they would work. Now, in a basket for a hot air balloon, you have slightly more space, but I don't know. I feel like you're so exposed. I would be worried about just falling out, you know?
You know, unless you're doing it, you know, doggy style over the rim, you know, if the bride almost falling out, then, you know, it would just be like having sex in a basket. You wouldn't know that you were in the sky.
I mean,
the intense heat of the heating element above you.
I mean, I would not. That's the thing, is I would not want to, if I were in a hot air balloon, any situation where I can see how high I am, I would immediately lose all desire to like fuck and just you know, I would just be like stuck to the ceiling like a cartoon cat. So this wouldn't work for me, but apparently this guy, this is his lifelong dream to just go up and away in his overblown balloon and with his new bride. They like all the people in the wedding are just like commenting on it. So that you, because you know, a normal thing you do when you get married, you go on a balloon ride. All right, sure, why not? I mean,
well,
it's not,
they were all talking about how weird it was, but
I mean, I guess this is the thing. It's like, it's not that getting married and going up in a balloon is so odd. Like, if it happened in real life, I'd be like, oh yeah, sure, why not? Yeah, you know, it's a thing some people might do, right?
Yeah,
but it's just such a, again, okay, another astounding coincidence for this goddamn stuffed dog to experience. But, you know, I feel like the dog doesn't really... I think the main thing
I don't think the dog appreciates it. The dog does not appreciate what we go through for it.
No. That's the thing is, like, I feel like in general, the dog is just a thing that is a device for linking these random events together. But it's not like the dog is, you know, somehow... Yeah, it's not like the dog is like coming into people's hearts, you know.
Do you remember a show in the 90s called Gun?
No. What was it about?
It worked pretty much exactly like this. It was an anthology show, and what linked all of the different things that happened every week was a gun that kept getting passed from hand to hand.
Oh, interesting.
The big stuffed gun.
The big stuffed gun. Well, so this dog, this is the thing. It is just an object that's passed around. I don't feel like there's anything special about the dog. Maybe
it didn't need to be Snoopy.
No, like maybe that the one with the old lady. Like, okay, I kind of see like, oh, you know, it's like she's reconnecting with her lost youth by seeing this dog and having someone to talk to. But other than that, it's just an object that gets passed around. It isn't like this is a special, there isn't anything special about the dog that, you know, people learn a lesson by interacting with him or something, you know?
You know, we really learned a lot from that big stuffed dog. Wow.
Yeah. Really makes you think. Makes you think about society.
Yeah. You know, having a big stuffed dog can teach you something about fishing, as it turns out.
It does, actually. That is true, because we forgot that there is a parallel plot. Our kid, Petey, the kid... His name is Petey, apparently.
Yes.
He arrives at his grandfather's.
After the dog from the Little Rascals.
Oh. Do you think that's on purpose?
Probably not.
Oh.
But well, then actually, again, I mean, Charles Schultz, you know, this is a big kind of nostalgia trip for Schultz. So it might be. I don't know.
Yeah, that's true. Big Little Books, Little Rascals, Charlie McCarthy, you know.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, he arrives at his grandfather's and immediately starts throwing a huge fit that his dog isn't there. But the weirdest thing about that is he never says it's a stuffed dog. So he just keeps saying, my dog is missing! My dog is missing! And everyone just acts like it's a real dog. It's like, at some point you might want to tell your grandfather it's a stuffed dog, because I think he thinks your actual pet dog has gotten lost on a plane. But...
You know, it would have been funnier if you had, like... To make up for it, we're going to go to the pet store and I get you a dog just as good as the last one.
Actually, that would be really funny.
Yeah, it's like, so what was your dog like? He's about 6 feet tall, had a big smile on his face, never said a word, had big eyebrows.
Well, I like when the kid...
Looked just like a character from the comics.
When the kid wakes up in the middle of the night. Like, he's all like, is my dog? Has anyone found my dog? Did you call my mom? Has she found my dog? And the grandfather's like, I called. She didn't answer. Because this is the day before cell phones. So,
yes.
You know, you just... he's like, they're probably out at a show. And the kid is like, how can they be at a show when my dog is missing? And it's like, kid, deal with it. I'm sorry. I mean, look, I know what it was like when you're a kid and you lose your favorite stuffed animal, but I don't care. get over it, kid. Like that. Look, I'm sorry. It happened. I remember that happened when I was a kid, and you just have to get over it. You just have to deal with it, you know. But like this little kid is such a little shit. He's like, my dog. Shut up. You get to go fishing with your grandfather. Be happy. Yeah. You know.
And now he's gonna catch a fish, and he's gonna be like, my fish. Are you taking care of my fish? Is my fish happy?
You know, this kid is all like, oh, you know, it's like, kid, you get to go fishing with your grandfather. That old lady would have killed for this opportunity. But no.
Yeah. She would have hit it off with your grandfather. You could have had a new grandmother.
Yeah. Maybe that was originally
what. Maybe that was her grandmother.
Maybe that's why she is listed as Petey's grandmother in the credits. Yeah. Well, luckily, it turns out that by an astonishing coincidence, that hot air balloon just happens to be flying over the lake where Petey and his grandfather are fishing. And
now, where did Petey fly to?
That is a very good question. He flew 10
Where did he fly to that a hot air balloon would also reach in the space of about a day?
Yeah, Petey, wow. Back in the old days, I guess when air flight was cheaper, you could just, you could just take these puddle jumpers around instead of driving.
Yeah. Now departing San Francisco for Salinas.
Yeah. but it is funny when the balloon shows up and the grandfather's like, that's the prettiest thing I've ever seen. And meanwhile, in the balloon, the bride is like, there's a guy and a kid in a boat down there. Like it's the most exciting thing that she's ever seen in her life. But I guess, you know, she's tired of spending time alone with her new groom because this guy, he's probably he's just.
No, he's spent the whole time being like, I want to be alone. And now this dog is looking at us. You know, what are we supposed to, it's our honeymoon. We got to take care of this dog.
Oh, that's right. Because he did want to throw the dog over, but like she wouldn't let him.
Yeah.
And until
and he's just kind of, you know, marching around like, you know, ruining his own honeymoon like he was Stuart Little and just. But then I love the part where Grandpa says, that's the most beautiful hot air balloon I've ever seen. And then we cut to the hot air balloon. It's like olive green. How beautiful.
I mean, it's a hot air balloon.
It's like an olive with a multicolored pimento. How majestic. I mean, oh, say, can you see?
It's a fairly drab hot air balloon by the standards of hot air balloons. But, you know.
It could be because we're watching this in potato VCR quality. But no, I think it's still green no matter what.
Yeah. I mean, it's not like. It's got like a little bit of a rainbow ring on it. But it is pretty like uninspiring as compared to a lot of other hot air balloons. But anyway, the bride then decides to drop the big stuffed dog and it falls.
Actually, she says, he jumped!
Wow. Wow.
Maybe the dog did do something. I don't know.
Okay, so the dog jumps. The dog jumps and it falls in the lake and then Petey starts losing his mind because it's his dog and his grandfather has to like catch it with a fishing line, with a fishing pole.
Yeah, and then they struggle to haul this sodden, lake water-filled stuffed dog up, and, you know, it's ruined now, but, you know, at least they acknowledge that, you know, that the dog can get dirty at all after all these adventures.
Yeah. Charles, I feel like this was like when they filmed The Magnificent Seven, you know, and they went down to Mexico. And the Mexican government was like, these Mexican peasants have to be spotless. We do not want a single smudge on their pristine white outfits to look bad to the American audience. So when you watch that film, like all the main cast looks like beat to shit, but all the Mexican peasants are in freshly laundered like silks throughout the whole film. So just Charles Schultz was like, I don't want the big stuffed dog white. He should be pristine the whole movie. I don't want anything. Snoopy does not get dirty. But anyway.
It's sort of like how all of the car manufacturers in whose cars are licensed to be in the Transformers movies demand that I know Bumblebee turns into a Chevy and then gets or he turns into a Corvette and then he gets a fusion cannon blasted at him. I don't care. I don't want the Corvette looking damaged. You know, make up something like they have, you know, holographic damage control or something.
Oh, do they do that?
Yeah, they do that. It's really irritating, honestly.
Wow. Oh my God, that sounds terrible. No wonder no one likes those movies, and yet they keep making them.
Yeah. Well, that last one was pretty good, but yeah.
Was it as good as the one where Orson Welles is in it?
Maybe. Oh. I mean, I'd have to watch it again because I've only seen it the one time, and I've seen the Orson Welles one multiple times. But you know, that last one was really good because they got rid of all the white people.
Oh well, okay. That's a horse of a different color. So
yeah, all POC cast, including the director. So it was a different look at Transformers that wasn't nearly as military oriented. So that helped a lot.
Interesting. All right. Well, maybe that's what it'll take to get me to watch a Transformers movie. So
yeah. Okay.
All right. Anyway, so the big stuffed dog has been returned to his rightful owner, and all is well with the world. That's the story of the big stuffed dog.
And we fade out over Lily, the little girl, meeting up with the Beagle Boys, who ask her how she got that big stuffed dog. Also, they're reading the paper and finding that some kid took home the raccoon and got the $5,000. And the leader of the Beagle Boys is like, "How do you get so good at throwing darts? Could you show me?" And everyone leaves in disgust. The end.
Yeah, it's these... yeah. I mean, it's a kids' movie. It's for kids, I guess.
Yeah, it's a kids, like, it's a family special for kids that ran as part of a something called like Peacock Parade or something.
I mean, I guess that's the thing. If you're gonna put something on TV in 1981, it, you know, when there's only four channels, you really did have to make it as complete pap. Because you gotta appeal to the widest possible audience. You can't put anything controversial or offensive in there, and you know it's for old people and also for children. So you get something like this where you just watch it and you're like, well, I guess that was for someone. It's for everyone and yet for no one. You know?
Yeah.
And
no wonder PBS was such a big deal at the time.
It's really just, I don't know. I watch this and I'm just like, I don't know. Charles Schultz sometimes he does tap into something and you feel like he really understands just like the pain of the world and can communicate it in a way that just, it hits. And this one, I'm just like, oh my God, come on. Just
shut the fuck up, Charles. Come on.
Yeah. It's like, I guess, I don't know. Like the jokes are,
Aren't funny. The sad parts are sad, but the jokes aren't funny. So I don't know. In some ways it feels like this is an Andy Kaufman bit.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, when you think about it, wasn't Charles Schultz's whole career now the Andy Kaufman bit?
Yeah, it kind of was. Well, except that, you know, he lived to be like 80. Well, you know, Andy Kaufman left us too soon, but yeah.
Well, this film, I watched it, and I will say this is probably on one of Schultz's lesser efforts. I just found it very tedious. I did not enjoy it. It's, I guess, slightly, I don't know. It's not as good as the girl in the red truck, I think. Now, I really think the girl in the red truck has a slight edge, if only because of the insane acting of Charles Schultz's daughter. Where she's like, yeah, Spike, yeah, want popcorn? Yeah, I like the roller skate, yeah.
Oh yeah, she's a delight. She really is. Honest. I mean, you love her ironically, and then you love her unironically. Like Torgo, you know?
Yeah,
she's the Torgo of that movie.
This one, it's interesting because we do have, like, for example, we said we have real actors. I think this is probably the only Schultz bit that has real actors. I can't think of, unless the new Peanuts movies that are coming out now, they probably have, I don't know if they're still doing the children thing or they got.
No, they have children, but the children can actually act now.
Oh, okay. I was going to say, they're not doing the celebrity voice thing right now. They're actually still doing kids. Interesting. Okay.
That would be pretty funny to have celebrities voicing the kids, the Peanuts kids, but I don't know.
Yeah. But I mean, this one, like we said, we got like, you know, Noah Beery Jr. We got Mel Stewart. We got Abe Vigoda. The head biker is played by, I forget his name, but you know him from
Gordon Jump. What a name.
That's it. WRK from Cincinnati. You know?
Oh, okay.
I think he was Herb in that one.
Mm. So these are all people that you knew from other shows, probably on NBC at the time.
Yes. Maybe that was the point of this. Maybe we were supposed to watch this and it's like NBC's cavalcade of stars. They're all coming out to meet the big stuffed dog. All your favorite NBC stars in one place. There's no...
Boy, imagine if this had been such a hit that instead of the Peacock Network, they started calling themselves the Big Stuffed Dog.
The Big Stuffed Dog. Everyone...
It's all this year. It's all this fall on the Big Stuffed Dog, NBC. Aroo!
Must-see TV with the Big Stuffed Dog. Everyone's... well, this was a film that appeared on television.
Yep.
Yep.
Well, I've learned my lesson. From now on, when I want a big stuffed dog, I'm just going to look through your OCs.
Ba-da-da-da-da-da. What?